Hello and welcome to Focus, the Catholic Answers podcast for living, understanding, and defending your Catholic faith. I'm Cy Kellett, your host, and this is the third part of a three-part series where we've been discussing with our president, Chris Cech, the Inquisitions of the Catholic Church, the various Inquisitions in the history of the Catholic Church. It all comes from a course that he has done for the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics. I highly recommend that you take that course or at least check out the courses that are being offered there in the School of Apologetics. You can do that by visiting schoolofapologetics.com, schoolofapologetics.com. This time we tackle the Spanish Inquisition. And frankly, when we Catholics talk about the Inquisition, or when anyone talks about the Inquisition, they're usually talking about the Spanish Inquisition. It has produced millions of nightmares, hundreds of different movie scenes, and some really good literature. But is it based on the truth? Is all that based on the truth, or is it based on black legend? Here's Chris Cech to help us understand it. Chris Cech, President of Catholic Answers, thank you for being with us again to talk about Inquisition. I'm going to just summarize. We've talked about the...
How many people have we executed so far?
While we've been doing these episodes?
On the Inquisition.
It hasn't been more than one or two a day, has it?
Yeah, it's
Darren? No. I missed the marketing department, but they had it coming.
Yeah,
okay. That's what they get for their heresies.
Yeah.
Okay, so we talk about the Inquisition in general, the medieval Inquisition. There's this thing called the Spanish Inquisition, which is what most people usually mean most of the time when they talk about the Inquisition.
Sure.
Right? So it turns out it's not that easy to talk about. There's a lot of twists and turns in the story of the Spanish Inquisition.
It's an involved story. I think, by the way, to your first point, it is the most discussed and best known. For one thing, it lasted the longest.
Mm-hmm.
And then Spain, of course, is the greatest empire of the modern period. So she's well known. And then Spain is the object of what we call black legend, originating in England first. And then also even in authors such as Edgar Allan Poe, for example. So the... popular understanding of the Inquisition or the Spanish Inquisition, exists through these forms.
So there's a way in which the whole history of the conflict between Spain and England, especially as it comes to the New World, as England leaves the Catholic Communion, in the English-speaking world, there develops, as you said, this black legend. And this is mostly what we know about the Inquisition. We know the legend.
Right, right. But the actual tale takes a little work to get our imaginations around. No country's history summarizes easily, Cy.
Right.
Spain's is especially tangled. I mean, even going back in particular, going back to the Roman period, you've got Romans, Visigoths, Carthaginians, eventually Arabs come in. We have the largest Jewish community in time in Europe, the largest Jewish community outside of the Holy Land. And then we have a period of 7 centuries of war that we call the Reconquista, of Christians taking back inch by inch, yard by yard, of the Iberian Peninsula from Muslim invaders.
I got to stop you there because I get my history from Time Magazine and the Washington Post. And what actually happened was the Muslims were completely peaceful and innocent. And it was the evil Catholics who ended the convivencia. Convivencia.
Yeah, and we can get derailed on that particular topic. I'm going to recommend a book called The Myth of the Andalusian Paradise that addresses this question that everyone lived peacefully under Islamic rule. It's false. They did not. But there were three... I want to respect time here. There are two kinds of conflicts, and they very much overlap in the Venn diagram. One is a religious conflict, and you have three principal groups: Jews, Christians, and Muslims. And there are certainly periods of, and you use the exact word, convivencia, where these three groups basically get along.
Mm-hmm.
There are even accounts of common prayer services, right? So all of you Catholics who get exercised about when the Methodist and the Catholics get together and pray for something, and we shouldn't be doing that, that's false ecumenism. My goodness, please. But there are examples of common prayer services in the cases of drought, for example, or famine. But that said, this is always a relationship of unequals. So it's either Christians and Jews living under Islamic rule, or Muslims and Jews living under Christian rule. So that's the first dynamic. The second one that begins to take the center of the stage as the Reconquista progresses are just the civil conflicts among the princes of the Iberian Peninsula and Portugal. Those kind of, so you have Castile, you have Aragon, you have Al-Andalus, which is what we call Muslim-occupied Spain, or what Muslims call it. But those civil conflicts start to get resolved with the Great Marriage around 1480 of Ferdinand and Isabella, which is one of the great marriages of history and unites in a marriage in the main the Iberian Peninsula. So that's kind of some kind of
Ferdinand
quick background.
And Isabella, for people in our part of the world, are the people who sent Christopher Columbus.
It's important that the discovery of the Americas is a Spanish event. I mean, I know it's an Italian who had the courage and the brains and the imagination and, frankly, the genius to do it, but it's Spain that pays for it. Yeah, and believed in it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
So a great, sure. So, but all of this, historic event of Spain being the discoverer does have enormous consequences in the coming centuries, consequences we still live with that are felicitous for us even to this day.
Well, and I know, and we've talked about Christopher Columbus. I mean, Spain doubles the size of the world, and we're getting to the end of the story here, but I'm going to give it something away. Were it not for the Inquisition in Spain and the religious unity and cultural unity that was the consequence of this Inquisition, you could make the case that Spain would not have had it sufficiently together to lead the age of exploration in the way that she did.
Yeah. So, but my
we're
point
getting
was,
way ahead.
But it's reasonable in this case because this is what we tend to know about Ferdinand and Isabella. But there's another, I mean, this is a small part of their story, actually, their discovery of America from their perspective.
Right.
And so tell us about the beginnings in 1492, I think, actually, of the Inquisitions.
Well, with the conquest of Granada, right, in 1492, and Catholic Europe and the Iberian Peninsula and Catholic Europe are made whole again. Now, in the middle episode of this trilogy side, we talked about the medieval Inquisition. The medieval Inquisition was quite successful in Spain, and it actually didn't really have to operate that much in Spain. But Spain wasn't afflicted with heresy the way that southern France was. However, there was a thing, a kind of person in Spain that if we don't try to understand, none of this will make sense to us. And this person is called a converso. And the conversos were Jewish converts to Christianity, some sincere and some not sincere. Now, how did we get these? Well, in that civil strife that I described, and now we're actually going to go back about a century before 1492, so into the 14th century, the 1300s. In that civil strife, as Christianity is becoming the dominant faith and political power in Spain during the Reconquista, and then there is this civil strife among the Christian princes of Spain, there is, in the middle of all this civil strife, a reaction against the growing Jewish population. And why? Well, they do practice usury. they have a role in the slave trade. So there are two objections there that both rich and poor Christians objected to. And then the jealousies and bigotries, let's be very honest here, that happen when you've got this civil and religious mix, conflict underway. I'm summarizing here, Cy, I apologize. It comes to a head in the form of a number of, how do you say this, pogroms?
Yeah.
And there are Jews who are given a choice. They can be, at the point of a sword, they can become Christians or they can die. Now, let's be clear. The church objects strongly to people being constrained to accept baptism.
The Lord objects strongly.
Sure, he does.
Clearly,
yes. But in fact, this did happen.
Right.
And this took place in the 14th century in Spain during all this time of conflict. Okay, so that's the first fact that people have to understand. Jews became Christians. Some sincerely, and some not sincerely. And there are so many of them, it's hard to say which one's sincerely and which one's not. As time proceeds, Jews are offered, or conversos rather, are offered the opportunity to return to the Jewish religion. Now, some take that offer, some do not. The ones who do not have a variety of motives. They now, given their Christian status, find themselves more successful in society, and that may in fact be part of it. They may feel unwelcome to return to the Jewish community because they or their ancestors abrogated. But again, summarizing very quickly, as time proceeds towards the end of the 15th century, we have this body of people called conversos. And now, by the end of the 15th century, the descendants of these conversos are also called conversos. And it's not clear who among them is a faithful Christian and who isn't. And then going back to the point that we were underscoring in the very first episode of this trilogy, your faithfulness to the Christian religion
has civil consequences.
Thank you, Cy, is bound up in the common good.
Right.
Yeah.
So the civil ruler is concerned, are you really Christian or not?
And as Ferdinand and Isabella come into power, Muslims are resurgent. Mm-hmm. And there's an event, in fact, not in Spain, in Italy, in Otranto, around 1480, where there's a Turkish galley, comes to the town of Otranto. Benedict went to visit this shrine when he was pope, and hundreds, they land at the town, and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of Christians are executed. You can see today the skulls there in the church honoring the martyrs. So Ferdinand and Isabella are feeling a threat from insurgent Islam within and without Spain, and what they need is political unity. And mitigating against or fighting against political unity is a certain number of conversos who now, in fact, are even in the church. There are priests, there are bishops who are conversos. Okay. And some of them are loyal subjects of the crown and loyal Catholics, and others are, in fact, engaged in conspiracy against both. And so now it's necessary. Are you with me so far?
Yeah, it's a very complex situation, though.
And so now you have this situation where the crown needs to know who's loyal and who is not, and baptism is not something that can be offered to demonstrate loyalty because these people are already baptized.
Uh-huh.
So now you need some kind of a test. And this is how, this is, it is these set of circumstances that I've done such a ham-fisted job of describing that lead to the Inquisition in Spain.
But my sense of the Inquisition, and correct me if I'm wrong, this might be a naive sense, that at least part of the concern for having a test is that conversos were facing unjust persecution from people who would just torture them and kill them without a test.
You are absolutely right. And by the way, this goes back to what we were talking about in the second episode, where we wanted to distinguish between the people who in fact were Albigensians and those who were genuine Christians who were now victims of the same kind of vigilante or mob justice that now we're finding in Spain, in Sevilla, for example.
So the civil authorities are concerned to prove this is a good Christian, leave this person alone,
and
is part of what they
want to
do.
And in fact, Cy, and this is a fact of history, it's in Henry Kamen, it's in Stanley Payne, it's in Edward Peters, who are the three really first-rate historians of the Inquisition in our time. The principal people calling for an Inquisition in Spain were conversos who wanted to demonstrate that they, in fact, were loyal Christians.
Right. So you go back to at the roots of all of this, it is, in fact, injustice against Jews.
Yes.
Without question. And
yes.
So we don't want to elide that fact. But now you have a new thing called the converso.
100 years later.
Yeah. And so—
What do you do?
And so the converso says, well, I don't want to get just beaten up by the mob. How do I prove my faith? And
right.
We end up with the Inquisition. Again, everything in Spain is an oversimplification because it's the most complicated situation in the world.
It
but
is.
In general terms, I think that's okay, so there's our outline.
I got to say, Cy, if someone really wants to make an honest stab at getting his imagination around Spain, pick up the work of Stanley Payne. I don't know if he's retired or not. He taught at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, but he has a book, and I'm not going to get it exactly right, but it's something like An Unusual History of Spain or An Unorthodox History of Spain, something like that. And it's quite good, and he's a sound, balanced historian I recommend, but also Henry Kamen and Edward Peters, not our Edward Peters, the canon lawyer, but Edward Peters, the historian. They're very good.
All right. So help us what okay. happened in the Inquisition then. So we see where the roots of it are, what happened.
Right. So the Pope Sixtus, Sixtus the Fourth, 1478, issues a bull. It's called Exigit Sincere Devotionis, calling for an Inquisition in Spain. The monarchs, Ferdinand and Isabella, they say, well, you know what? We're not going to use an Inquisition first. Let's try a period of apologetics first.
Yeah.
So they launch a Catholic Answers and try to spread catechesis and apologetics throughout Spain for a period of a year or two.
By the strict letter of the law, they were disobeying the Pope by going easy.
They were saying, we're not going to do this yet.
Oh, just yet.
Yeah.
Okay, gotcha.
Exactly. Let's see if we can just try some catechesis.
Yeah.
Yeah. But no, things do heat up. Otranto is the good example, and then civil unrest, and so now they do have to implement enact the Inquisition, and so it's in this atmosphere. And I'm looking at my notes here. I gotta cheat here and look on the camera. They take the manuals of Bernard Guy and Nicholas Emmerich, and eventually it's Tomas Torquemada who gets a bad rap, but he takes it over and he applies the care of these medieval Dominicans. Most of the excesses that we see in the Spanish Inquisition take place in the initial period before Torquemada takes over. There are maybe about 2,000 executions in this period. The executions slow dramatically after Torquemada takes over. And if we set aside the first year or so, and then take it into the 19th century, because it lasted a long time, It's maybe something like two or three executions a year. So,
but where's the part where like hundreds of thousands?
Yeah, millions, right? Exactly, that the population wouldn't even have supported. Yeah. And then there are other myths here as well, Cy. You know that it was anti-Semitic. Well, Jews as unbaptized persons and Muslims, for example, as don't fall under the authority of an ecclesial court.
There were anti-Jewish things like being expelled from the country.
Yeah, although that happened in France and it happened in England, not so much in Spain. Yeah.
Oh, okay. So it was actually milder in Spain.
Yeah,
I didn't know that.
Yeah, yeah. Largest, as I said, largest Jewish community outside of Israel.
But I make that just by way of contrast that the Inquisition, whatever violence it could do, it couldn't do it against Jews because be a subject of the Inquisition.
They weren't subject to ecclesial courts. Yeah. Muslims were, for that matter. We're not.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's how it came to pass, and it was administered with care. And there's a Sorbonne historian, Jean Dumont, I think is his name, and he makes the argument that if the Inquisition should be remembered for executions, which, by the way, were carried out by the state, not by the church, when someone was found guilty, same as with the medieval Inquisition, or if it should be remembered for torture, it should be remembered that it was the exception among the secular courts of Europe in its use of these things. In its mild or infrequent use of these things.
Right.
But that, of course, is not the impression, as we were talking about at the beginning here, that people have of this. It was the most advanced, we would say most modern, you know, court of its age. And then all the, you know, there's so many examples of people deliberately blaspheming or accusing themselves of heresy so that they could have their secular case, if they were being tried by a secular court, transferred to the courts of the Inquisition. The prisons were better. In many cases, people weren't even put in prisons. They were just consigned to house arrest, or they would say, you know, Cy, you can't leave. You have to stay in Oceanside.
Right.
Right.
Yeah. Which is not so bad.
No, I know you have to go to the beach every day. Right?
Sevilla or Toledo? Right. When does the Black Legend then get going? I mean, let's just make a kind of moral judgment then. This is not, we wouldn't be advocating a return to the Inquisition, but a reasonable understanding of the Inquisition places it in its time and place where virtually every court on earth would have used torture in one way or another. Execution would have been much more common. It's just a different world. And certainly there are insights that the church and the world will have in the coming centuries that have not been had yet. You wouldn't say, well, let's do that again. Let's have another Inquisition. But what would you say as a moral judgment on the Inquisition?
As we talked about, I know earlier, we do have still an Inquisition. We just call it the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith. But you're right. We're not torturing people.
Yeah, but the worst that's likely to happen is a strongly worded letter. I mean, literally nothing else can happen. I guess you could lose your faculties at a Catholic university in some places.
Well, and also worth saying, and actually that would be quite good. There are probably a lot of people teaching at Catholic universities who should lose their faculties.
Right.
But we should also point out, Cy, that the trying and torturing and executing of heretics is not a Catholic preserve. The Catholic Church is the only.
Of course not.
Calvinists did this in Geneva,
right,
and it was done in England as well. So the Black Legend really kicks in the 19th century. There's an edition in the 19th century by the Reverend Ingram Cobbin, which is a new edition of Fox's Book of Martyrs. In his introduction to Fox's Book of Martyrs, which actually has nothing to do with the Spanish Inquisition, he describes you know, these fantastic instruments of torture, like an Iron Maiden, you step across the line and it springs a trap, and then the female doll embraces you and you're pierced with 1,000 knives. And then Edgar Allan Poe, of course, as well, with Pit and the Pendulum. So that black legend really starts to kick in the 19th century as we need to retell the story of how evil Philip II was in 1588, sending his armada to England with the hulls of the ships laden with the torture devices of
right.
Yeah. Interestingly, with respect to torture,
the English Reformation was probably worse.
Yeah. Well,
I don't know if you want to make a judgment like that, but when you think about some of the tortures inflicted during the English Reformation,
the drawing and quartering. Think about this is a uniquely English practice of ripping somebody's insides out while he's still alive and watching it take place. This is something for which the English really take pride of place. But as far as torture goes, you know, Torquemada says he largely, we talked about the strappado, dislocating the
shoulders.
He does away with that, and his the method of torture that was used in Spain infrequently, probably in about 2% of cases, if not less, was something akin to waterboarding. Now, by the way, I feel very strongly that waterboarding is torture. I've just gone on the record saying that, and I oppose it, and I oppose its use by our government, and I think the Catholic Church does too.
Yeah.
But nonetheless, we do see, as you say, a progression away from these kinds of tortures that were used throughout medieval Europe.
I asked you kind of how we make a moral assessment of this. I mean,
Oh, I know, and I avoided the question.
Was that intentional? Or
no, I got distracted because I think there was something else I wanted to underscore. Okay,
yeah.
Ask the question again.
So in the light of what we can say, I mean, rejecting the black legend and all of that, but not trying to elide the truth in any way. What kind of moral judgment might we pass on the Inquisition, given, you know, the limits of our own abilities in that regard too?
So I think a couple of things for Catholics. One, first of all, if they're going to talk about this, a little bit of a command of the history is going to make it easier for them to do. I know that's not answering your question. The second thing, getting your imagination around the figures so that when someone says to you, hundreds of thousands were burned, you know, at an auto da fe. An auto da fe, by the way, was a mass. Nobody was ever burned at one. An auto da fe was a mass that brought the repentant heretics back into the church. It was an occasion of celebration, an act of faith. So getting some of those facts right, but also being able to say, look, as we talked about in the first episode, Si, there was a time in human history when heresy was understood to be a threat to someone's eternal salvation. So if we're going to make a moral judgment about this, you and I have to agree, whoever I am talking about this, that eternal damnation is the worst thing that's going to happen to you or could happen to you, right? There's nothing worse that's going to happen to you. Losing your arm is not as bad a thing as eternal damnation, right? Getting the chicken pox, right?
Yeah.
Not as bad. So if you can get someone to say, I agree with you, then that eternal damnation is the worst thing that can happen to you, and it's a very, very bad thing, then you can say, all right, I understand a civic institution, if you will, in this case, an ecclesial institution that wants to save people, those in heresy and those who might be influenced by them from that fate. And if there's an excess of zeal that tips over into wickedness, I get where they're starting from.
Yeah,
right?
I get the starting point, right, but without denying that that's a great – it tips into wickedness.
Yeah.
It doesn't on a time. But, I mean, almost every human endeavor taken with great passion tips into some kind of wickedness.
Sure,
I mean,
excess.
Just,
yeah.
That's just how we are.
Absolutely.
Again, I just don't want to feel like we're completely excusing, but you do want to make a judicious moral assessment. What if somebody wanted to take your class and be like, I want to learn more about what this Chris Check guy says about the
SchoolofApologetics.com.
SchoolofApologetics.com.
It's a, you know, I had a lot of fun doing it, and I want to give credit to those guys, John Brasillo and his crowd in the video department. They do superb work, and they built that beautiful set. My class or Tim's or Trent's or Jimmy's, they're really well done. I'm so proud of our School of Apologetics and the work that those guys are doing. And honestly, Donna Barrick in marketing is always offering some kind of a deal. There's probably a deal right now. I don't happen to know what it is.
Well,
we're always giving away
right
the farm
now. Could be
here.
Because people could watch this 2 years from now. So
that's true.
Whatever the deal is, I don't. But there's probably a deal 2 years from now.
If
too.
There isn't a deal on this, wait 7 days because Donna's probably and Carrie Beck they'll be offering one. But yeah, my class is you'll get through it you could do it in a day if you wanted to. I think it's 14 lessons. Totaling maybe 2 hours, something like that. And there's a study guide and a quiz at the end of it. Our own operations officer, John Sorensen, took it and he said it was brilliant.
Really? Good for him. And where is he in the org chart in relation to
you? Directly under.
He's directly under you. Okay. Yes. Chris Check, President of Catholic Answers, thank you very much for all of this conversation about the Inquisition. It's really, really been a great conversation.
God bless you, Si.
You too. Thank you. Certainly with a topic as complicated as the Spanish Inquisition, in a short time, you're just not going to be able to cover everything. So that's somewhat impressionistic, what you'll get from us today or from this video. But if you'd like more, you can take Chris's course at schoolofapologetics.com or take any of the courses. Just check out the courses. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. If you have an idea for a future episode, maybe there's something in Catholic history that you'd like some more clarification on. You know, I'm sure we'll get to Galileo one of these days. There's a lot more always to do on the Crusades. If you have an idea, send it to radio@catholic.com, radio@catholic.com. If you're watching on YouTube, please like and subscribe. That's how we grow on YouTube. We are growing on YouTube. We're really happy with the growth we've had on YouTube, but we'd like to continue to expand there. So if you would like and subscribe, that will help. If you get us on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, anywhere else where podcasts are available, if you subscribe there, you'll be notified when new episodes are available. And if you give us that five-star review and maybe a few words, that will help to grow the podcast. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm Si Kellett, your host. We'll see you next time, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Focus.